motion to approve those minutes?
Make that motion. I'll second it.
Made by Mike, seconded by Ralph. Any changes? Any need for amendments? Being none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any extensions? Motion carries. Next item is acceptance of agenda as printed. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved. I'll second.
By Ralph, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any extensions? Motion carries. And we're down to communications and correspondence. And before we get to the recreational complex, I wanted to point out that we did have a certificate of recognition that I did give to the Portland Garden Club on their 70th anniversary. They first had their meeting on May 5th, 1947. And for 70 years, the Garden Club has offered educational programs to members and to our community on the culture and care of flowers, fruits, vegetables, plants, trees, and conservation of natural resources. And it's been the Garden Club's mission to serve the community by promoting civic improvements and beautification of the town of Portland. And on behalf of the Board of Selectmen, I presented this certificate to them on the 6th day of September, along with our thanks for all the work that they've done for over 70 years in our town. And with that, we'll open it up to Brian. He's here on the Route 17 Recreational Complex Building Committee. And Mr. McCarthy is the chairman of the committee. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. It's been a little while since I've been here, but the committee has been busy, so I'd like to just recap what we've been doing and kind of what the next steps are. So the our design engineer kind of started work back in August, so we went for a while. We were kind of doing a lot of planning and brainstorming the committee months before that. We really get started in earnest on any of the kind of pushing towards the finish line until August. That's primarily been finalizing some of the design. The design that was completed in 2015 was at about 90% level. Some other work needs to be done. And we also we had some permitting issues that we needed to address as well. So the permits and approval side, we got the town inland wetlands approval. So there's some disturbance of wetlands in the upland area. Coordinated with the town sanitarian on septic issues and preserving test pits and what was required there. Applied to the Connecticut DOT and had several, at least one meeting and some correspondence for the reconfiguration of the park entrance to Route 17 Strickland Street. We're just awaiting one other issue from the state DEP, actually. There's a question by DOT that did we receive any state money for the project, and we received, if you recall, a state grant for the conceptual work back in 2013, 2015. And the time frame was, there's a question of whether that creates a trigger that, in DOT's mind, then requires a additional floodplain certification by DEP. But once that happens, then we'd be able to kind of submit the final report to Connecticut DOT on that. And we've also requested deep review. It's not a mandatory approval or permit that we need, but for them to review the turf management plan that's been put together that essentially describes, you know, would describe, you know, where there are already soils with any residual contamination that remain on the property, where they're buried, what the procedure would be for doing any kind of excavation work or keeping those isolated from the community and so on. So it's a pretty straightforward document, but we're just looking to get deep to us that. So that's where we are on permits and approvals. Progress in design, the committee has been very active and working collaboratively with the engineer, fine-tuning equipment choices for playgrounds, splash pad, so on, structures, field configuration, and so on. I've also been developing a detailed cost estimate. And within that, we've also been looking at balancing capital and O&M costs. have now to save money on capital that's going to cost the town additional money. So one example of that is a water repurposing system for the splash pad, where we can capture the water that comes through there, and within a day or two, be able to repurpose that for irrigation. That saves some money for buying fresh water, and it's a little bit of a green feature as well, in terms of wasting money. So there's some additional capital cost for that, but you know, we anticipate that's about a 5 or 6 year payback period on that, depending on the usage. So, you know, as an example, that's something there. We're also trying to, with the restroom concession utility building and the barn, trying to again balance something that's going to be durable and not require a lot of maintenance, with you know something that in our budget. So we are committed to meeting the $6 million all-in budget project, and to do that, we're looking at structuring the design and bid proposal to include some ad alternates. It's a good exercise to go through something like this, where you get the engineer's opinion of cost. It tends to be a little bit conservative. You don't want to be a low bidder. But so we want to be using their guidelines as a budget to try to stay there, as well as having soft costs for oversight, bonding, and so on. We want to make sure that we have a project that's affordable the first time we bid it, and to have, you know, if the bids come in favorably, then we'll have options to kind of add in the, you know, the features that are, I'll call them nice to have, some people they're must haves, but it's all a matter of, you know, we're committed to keeping all the amenities in the park that were the initial design. It's just a matter of, we have to cut out one piece of equipment or some other pieces of equipment to make that, or make a shrink of field size a little bit or something like that. We'll try to do that as well, to think about items that would be easy to modify or enhance later on, you know, with lower cost of labor. We have that now, about something that would require a lot of disturbance. So the remaining items to do, we've got the state approval of the entrance. As I mentioned, we're working on the design is essentially done. We're finalizing our choices and options and kind of going back and forth and looking at the costs and so on. Again, putting an affordable package together. And I would anticipate that we'd be kind of ready to advertise or have a complete package by the end of January. So that still puts us in a time frame to bid this winter and break ground in the spring. And I'd be happy to take any questions.
Any other questions?
What sequence of completion do you think will happen with this simple splash pad field?
In terms of what might be ready for, I'm not sure what might be ready for use in, you know, we started construction in spring of 2018. Could be anything for use by fall of 2018, maybe not. It would be kind of tough. You know, it's still a lot of earthwork to do there, and you want to keep it. You know, it'll still be a site under construction, and so, you know, there's some safety issues there. But I would anticipate, you know, certainly within 2019, there'll be some phasing of things to be available. Probably, you know, playgrounds might be ready for use before fields, giving, you know, turf time to establish and so on. So that's something I can look into the phasing plan and what the schedule is.
Do you think this is going to be ready for 2019, 2020?
Yeah, I would anticipate 2000. There would be some available use in 2019. I wouldn't say, you know, first 100%. Spring 2019, but you know, probably, you know, at some point during 2019, okay, it would be phased in and start being used.
What's the biggest challenge? Will it be the fields themselves that will take the longest to actually get used out of?
I think the fields, because you just don't want to start playing sports on the fields until you give the turf a chance to mature. But, you know, that's, crushes.
Sort of like the soccer folks and the baseball folks, the pilot looking at, you know, some tournaments and stuff like that in 2020.
Yeah, they're aware of the time frame. They're, you know,
it's a pretty enthusiastic.
Yeah, in touch with what's going on with the work. There's, you know, people on the committee who are close to both organizations, soccer, baseball, as well as other in town. So people, they're right at the table with us, knowing what we're doing in terms of decisions and making choices about, again, nice to haves versus must haves in terms of things like fencing or benches and this, that, and the other. And I would just like to add again that the committee has been very active and rolled up their sleeves tremendously and put in time in terms of particularly looking at researching equipment that's available, going around to different playgrounds, looking at, you know, what's out there, what do people use, what do they like, what's kid tested, what isn't, you know, kind of stands the test of time, and so on. So there's been a lot of research and hard work done by the volunteers on the committee to I think, to make sure that we get something that's going to be valued and useful. So I can't say enough about it.
Any other questions?
Not a question, but just a comment that I've been able to work as previously prior to joining this board on the committee, and then also as the liaison to the committee. Pass along the thanks for the hard work. There have been a lot of extra nights, not just the two meetings a month, but the committee members have been meeting separately, meeting with vendors, doing a lot of their own research to really try to get the best value and really get the best products out there for a good, sustainable park. So been a good effort.
So hopefully we'll be, have some good news in the time of January that we are, you think we're ready to go. So it's taking a little bit longer than we all have wanted since 2012 or 2016 when the referendum passed, but it took us a while to get going next year. But again, since we started really in earnest over the summer with kind of getting things pushed, we've made a lot of progress. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Public comment? Okay. The next item under old business, renaming of the town park and ball field at 97 Caroline Avenue. Right now that's called Brownstone Park. And the difficulty is for people who are trying to find Brownstone Exploration and Discovery Park, they end up on Airline Avenue for a softball game, and it's the wrong place because they're thinking that's Brownstone Park. So we brought it up to the Parks and Recreation Commission, and I spoke with Carl Johnson and with Sean Dwyer earlier this afternoon, and they're recommending that it be renamed William J. Nolan Field as opposed to Brownstone Park. And William J. Nolan, for those of you who may not have been around, but he was the director of Parks and Recreation. He did a fine job and really brought us a
good evening
and way
quarter of eight
in terms of Parks and Recreation in his community. And I believe it's a little before my time, but I hear he had a lot to do with the building of that particular
thank you
park.
And have a good evening.
And I believe we only need a motion by the selectmen for this. That's what I know of today. Anybody want to comment before we go ahead?
Yeah, I just one comment. I think that, I may be mistaken, but I think it's right now, it's called two things, Nolan Field and Brownstone Park.
Yes.
So we're going to call it Nolan Field or Nolan Park.
Field.
Okay. It'll be no park at all. It'll be a field.
What I was recommending.
Okay, good.
They said there used to be a playground down there, but they've removed that, so really it is just a softball field right now. There is a small area, I guess, that you could walk, perhaps, but there's not a there's not a park per se.
And just to piggyback on what you said earlier is that Bill was Mr. Recreation, Park and Rec in Portland. He took care of the fields. He took care of the schedules, he took care of the coaches, he took care of the uniforms, he in his back of his trunk of his car, he'd drop off the soccer balls at the different coaches' houses. He was at every game. Bill was Mr. Park and Rec for Portland when we started. So I think this is a very worthy recognition, and also distinguishing between Brownstone Park and Golden View.
Good. It was like that Ben Saber buck. It was all in the plan, it was all in the plan.
And Bill's family still lives in Portland, and I think it's a fine tribute to a fine family in our town, and such a worthwhile endeavor in terms of good, healthy parks and recreation for youth and adults. A lot of adults play softball down there, so it's not just for youngsters, but also for older folks as well.
Would you like me to make a motion?
Yes, please. William J. Nolan Field?
Oh, sorry, William J. Nolan Field.
Thank you, Ben.
And I'll second that.
Seconded by Lou. Further discussion or questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries. And God bless Bill. We certainly miss him and his work that really we're building on under here. The next thing is talking about ordinances. Since our animal control officer isn't here yet, I'm going to wait just a couple minutes, and we'll start with the storm water ordinance that you have in your packets. I don't know if any of you have anything to say about this ordinance. It's something that Rick Kelsey had brought to my attention. It's something that we need to have per state law. And we had a public hearing on this ordinance, and there were no comments on it. I have not as yet, and Rick, correct me if I'm wrong, we have not sent this for attorney review.
No, and I'm not absolutely sure you're, but that's up to you.
Did you have any comments on it, Rick?
Well,
any changes?
I think very briefly, it is something that is required as part of our general stormwater permit. This particular ordinance was prepared by our town engineer for the town of Durham. It seemed somewhat the test of time. It's kind of it's an ordinance that, you know, you're kind of working for the DEEP. You have to have it. It's probably not a ordinance that's going to get used very frequently, or hopefully. Ben had a couple comments last time we discussed this prior to the public hearing, and I've looked it over, and I kind of tend to agree with it to some degree. And if I, very briefly.
Hope your memory is better than mine.
Well,
I only saw one so far.
I actually circled them when you brought them up. Without getting into great deal of detail, page one, section two, best management practices. It says here on about the fourth page, fourth sentence. Reduce the discharge of pollutants directly or indirectly to stormwater receiving waters. Indirectly is the real intent here is, for a good example, would be someone that it happens in places where someone will change their oil over a catch basin is a good example. The word indirectly, if you look at it throughout the document, maybe gets a little bit more than practically what you're going to see. I mean, indirectly could be about anything. I mean, you know,
fertilization.
And it does further go on to give the first selectman latitude as to what's fortunate. A good example would be we see on the Salter Roads. But it provides for an exemption for that, for example. You might consider removing the word indirectly.
Rick, what if you just took out both and just said discharge of pollutants to stormwater receiving water?
That's fine, too.
So if you just took out directly or indirectly, it kind of leaves it
That's
broad
one.
Enough to say.
Yep, that's fine. It comes up again on page two under illegal discharge, the same type of thing. In illegal discharge shall mean any direct or indirect non-stormwater discharge, and I agree. Maybe a better way is take the words direct or indirect out of it. I agree. that's probably a better, more simpler way. If you look at page four, without getting too wordy into this thing, section seven provides exemptions, such as waterline flushing, lawn irrigation. So it does take into account that there are other discharges or circumstances that do contribute to the stormwater system. And it does provide under B that, for example, discharge is specified in writing. The question is, writing where? Where you know, that she could, Susan could exempt certain things, such as, you know, the use of liquid de-icers on our roads and those types of things. So it does provide some latitude for you to make some concessions where it's practical. Not so, really, that's fine. The only question I have is I'm not exactly sure where in writing, where you would put these things in writing is more of a question than anything else.
Well, did I say in C, in terms of the dye testing?
Dye testing, yeah. They,
it says written notification may be in the form of.
Yeah, that's a little bit more for example, the sewage treatment plant receives occasionally we'll get a discoloration of water. Or when someone comes in and wants to, has a process and they're going to be discharging whatever it is to the sewage treatment plant. They need to get our permission to do that. So maybe that's I think what the dye testing thing is. But again, I don't think there's anything drastically wrong. I wouldn't get too excited over any of it. I'm just wondering where writing. You know, let's say you were to say, Susan, that an exempted discharge would be sand and salt on our roads, which would be very practical. Where writing would. Where would it say that?
Well, you can take that out.
Well, again, I would think that's also practical. Again, I look at these things and they're legally written, and sometimes they make them a little more complicated than they probably need to be. So that would be a good one. If you just, I think, fine, discharges
specified
by the first selectman as being necessary. I agree. I don't want to block you into something that really you never had to do. Ben brought up, when you get to page 7, section 12, for example, water course protection. You know, it gets a little impractical. It says, every person owning property through which a water course passes shall keep and maintain that part of the water course within the property free of trash, debris, excessive vegetation, and other obstacles. I mean, I don't know how you're ever going to enforce something like that. I mean, I have property up there that's 100 acres that's got all kinds of water courses on it, and I don't have any intention of going out there and cutting the brush. Plus, I'm not sure without a wetlands permit you could even do it. So, again, all I'm trying to say is the intent here is good. Be careful with some of this wording because it's typical DEEP stuff that becomes very onerous and impractical in many cases. So, you know, the beavers, Ben brought that. So I got beavers and stuff, and they block the water course. And, you know, what am I going to go out there and shoot the beavers or trap the beavers? Under that one, water course protection, maybe it could be somewhat more generic or simplified or less specific, and you'll still be comfortable with it.
Maybe keep the tent trash and debris, that sort of thing, because that obviously
that's
makes
fine.
Sense.
Sure.
But I think
ambient rods doesn't flow.
Yeah, and there's a flip side to this. You're legally giving someone permission to just go mow down along every street with this document. You're insisting to do it. I don't think that's.
I don't think we need to talk about vegetation. That's more picking up the
correct. Litter. Correct. And I think that I feel the same.
I
have a bunch of wetlands.
Again, it's too specific. It doesn't need to be. And again, I really hope and probably realize you're probably never going to use.
You could also say free of items such as, or something, or every person owning property through which the water course passes, or such person's lessee. Shall do their best.
Yeah, something like that. Or, you know, you could take the word, just say every person owning the property through which a water course shall attempt to properly maintaining the water course so it's not just blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, I think that's.
Something more.
But you know what you see a lot of times, people just, especially if it's near a road, they just throw their litter in there.
Right.
You know, that's really what we don't want, or people throwing their old tires or
TV sets. Lots of times we'll get the call and then Rick's crew has to go out and do the job. So if he can say, our ordinance says you shall make every attempt to try to keep this clean.
Or you shall.
Point to this.
You kind of shall, but not get into the specifics of cutting vegetation and those things.
Yeah.
Keep it simple and practical. The only other, and again, some of these I circled. Ben had raised the question on page 10, and I don't really have a big issue with this, is that appeals would go to the entire board rather than the first selectman. I don't have any strong feelings about that at all. I don't know if you need to have all those appeals come to, I don't know, it's up to you.
Well, everything comes here, and people don't like what the office of first selectman says anyway.
So it's being open-minded, I would hope you would never
have that. Yeah, probably won't.
Exactly.
That's kind of it in a nutshell. I don't see anything else that's too crazy. The reality here is this. We received a notice of violation for not having this amongst many other notices of violations of all kinds of, I'll say this with due respect, foolish other things. Nothing of any consequence. And I had to write them a response saying we would have this particular item and others squared away within a couple of months. While we're at the couple months time, and I have to submit my annual report, which is by the end of the year, so it would be kind of good if we could. I can in my report say the Board of Selectmen is reviewing an ordinance, and that probably suffices. But it would be better to say the Board of Selectmen has adopted it.
Well, if you look at page one, I don't think Rick, don't go anywhere. I don't think these are substantive changes. If on page one we change, take, delete directly or indirectly under section two definitions. On page two, under illegal discharge, shall mean any, take out direct or indirect non-stormwater discharge. No changes on page three. On page four, letter B as a boy under section seven, take out the word in writing. Page five, no change. Page six, no change. Page seven, every person owning property through which a water course passes or such person lessee shall attempt to keep and maintain. Add the word attempt to and leave everything else the same.
Well, would you imagine take out, could you just take out excessive vegetation?
Take it out,
right.
Just excessive vegetation.
Well,
we don't
I'll tell
you, pollution.
But I'll tell you, there's very often, and I can specifically remember times where we get calls because there is excessive vegetation. And on occasion, we have gone out and had to clear because it gets backed up because everything gets excessive. And we have a lot of problems with drainage in various areas. And I can think of my own neighborhood, probably my own yard. We need to make sure we keep the excessive vegetation clear. The other thing is that, you know, it all kind of dams up behind grass clippings or growth of vegetation. So there, I think people should attempt to clear out those areas.
Or
otherwise, that's my opinion.
No, I'm good. I was more worried about the idea.
It does happen, though.
It does happen.
And the town crew are the ones that go out. And I would like to be able to educate some of our citizens that maybe they're not aware that they should be doing this.
Well,
so that the water can flow freely. And then you can point to the ordinance that this is something that's good practices. You know, when we talk a little bit about our sustainability endeavors, it's more education for each of us to remind us that we need to take care of our natural resources and other areas within our yards or our properties to the best that we can. I don't think we have to be too onerous at this point on these kinds of things, but I do think we need to all be aware. No changes
Excuse me, Susan, could you just tell me the wording for that page 7?
Certainly.
You were talking about some.
Water course protection.
Yeah.
There's no change until you get to the word shall. Every person owning property through which a water course passes or such person's lessee shall, and then insert the words attempt to. And keep everything the same.
What about the excessive vegetation?
I think we should keep it. I think we should keep it. Because that is not unlike debris or garbage.
I'll be a little nervous about the brooks out on my property, but I'll get by. Yeah, I'll attempt.
I know you, Rick, you take care of your.
Yeah, yes.
I think where they're gonna be issues is fine. I think the ones that are.
Different.
Right, I think what you're saying makes sense, but my only fear, I see both sides. We are giving permission, laying down these streams. There's a difference between what water runoff, like behind Farrell's, for example, that's a.
That's one area I'm thinking of.
Man-made gully. I'm picturing these beautiful streams that have to run through my property. But if you want a document that says that I'm allowed to go.
You know where else we have problems? Been down by Riverside Marina. That gets blocked up.
Okay.
And we've gone down and helped, and then after a number of times of sort of telling the property owners, because there's more than one property owner, how they could maintain that property in terms of getting rid of the excess vegetation before it dammed up those streams, really has kept that culvert and that whole area cleaner and clearer, and they don't have the problem.
I guess our safety net is we still have one of those things, so we should still buy it.
That's a good point.
I guess my fears are from.
That's just attempt to. And the other thing is, if you find this, if you decide tonight to adopt this, we can always change it. There is a process to change these. This is more a statement that we have and are in compliance with maintaining the best we can for storm water maintenance. So with those changes, is there a motion to adopt the ordinance?
I'll make a motion to adopt.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Seconded by Jim. I thank you all for reviewing this, and as I said, we adopt it, and then it goes through a period of time by which we have to put it, notify it in the papers, and then we also have to wait a certain sufficient amount of time. If we don't get any petition to overrule, then it will become an ordinance. No questions on this at this point, because there's a motion on the floor and it's been made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Yes, Ben? Yes.
The motion was made to be amended.
Yes, thank you. As amended, correct. Ordinance as amended, and I think that would be in the in the motion then.
Yeah, I would agree with most of that.
Right, I think he's now thinking of free.
Let's go to, I think we're going to go to the animal ordinances. Hopefully Karen will come soon. Dave, did you have something?
No, I have to say.
Sorry, we're good.
Okay. So we're going to, I will, because I've asked for public comment to wait until we're talking about the animal ordinance, I'll open it up for public comment. Mrs. Devers, did you want to say anything at this point, or do you want to wait? Just give your name and street.
Pictures
so I took the
following and sent. If it passed those down, please. My name is
Maria Demers. You can't hear?
Yeah, I didn't catch your name.
I'm
sorry.
Maria Demers.
What's your last name?
D-E-M-A-R-E-S-T. Thank you. And your street is Omar Rotor. Thank you for coming.
On January 31st, 2016, my husband was attacked by an 80-pound pit bull. We have walked this route many times, and even with our branch open. And if you pass those pictures down, you will see what kind of attack there was and the damage that was done. We were walking across the street from where the dog lives. The dog came running down the driveway, across the street, circled us, and proceeded to attack my husband by pushing him down in the snow, biting his leg, ankle, back of his thigh. He was able to shake him off and get up. Again, the dog came after him and pushed him down in the snow again, locking his teeth and jaw into the upper leg groin area of my husband's left leg. My husband shook him off for a second time, got up, and the dog came after him a third time. This time, he gave the dog a karate kick to the head, stunned the dog long enough for my husband to get into the neighbor's car. Then it stopped when she saw what was going on. While I was getting into the car also, the dog came after me and tried to enter the car, squeezing me out. But with all my strength, I took the dog by the collar, pulled him back, and closed the door. While this was happening, the owner stood at the bottom of his driveway, never tried to get the dog off my husband, yelled at my husband for abusing the dog by kicking him. Needless to say, my husband was taken to the emergency room at Middlesex Hospital by Hunter Ambulance after being treated by the paramedics, who I might say were wonderful. After he arrived at the ER, the Portland police, who were also at the scene, arrived. The ER staff took care of him, stitched one of the wounds in the back of his leg, which I might add were not something they normally do because dog bites are dirty. He had and still has scars of the entire dog's mouth in the front of his shin, on his upper leg and groin area, scars along his ankle, and the back of his leg. He needed physical therapy, and we both needed PTSD therapy. The owner was ordered to bring the dog to the pound on February 1 the next day. The owner refused to put the dog down and has the right to appear in front of the Department of Agriculture. August of 16, we, along with two attorneys from the town of Portland, the animal control officer, the assistant animal control officer, went to Hartford to testify or listen to testimony. Your tax dollars paid for this. The agricultural department has not rendered this decision on this matter. Your tax dollars are being spent to house a vicious animal, pay for the animal control officer and the assistant to feed the animal and take care of him. The assistant is terrified of the animal, as she testified. The dogs growl at her and therefore will not take her out of the pen. Something has to change. Once a dog is deemed vicious, and I don't care how many times he bites or attacks another animal or human, should be put down. No questions asked. This dog was given to the owner by the animal control officer. Did she use correct judgment in assessing the prospective owner? Did he have the ability to exercise the dog? No, because he's disabled. Nothing ever appeared in the newspaper about this attack. Why was this cover-up? Was this not good judgment on the part of the animal control officer? Now, all of a sudden, because a dog died, in an attack of the Portland laws are being looked at. And I give my condolences to this family. People in our town do not care. It's always, my dog is friendly. Have you ever seen the animal control officer at the reservoir where people think their dogs can run free? Or the walking track on Rose Hill, just looking for stray dogs or dogs leaving their property? I personally have never. Both areas are posted with leashes required on the property. I have seen dogs come out at us. I've seen two Rottweilers running free at the reservoir. I don't know what people think these days. I personally have never seen any patrolling of these areas. Since the event, we have tried new routes, and always a dog has come off their property and ran towards us. We have reported these incidents to the animal control officer. Our life has changed dramatically. We now walk with phones, IDs, and spread, and only walk at the Rose Hill track or at the high school track. Now, people who know where I live know that the Rose Hill track is only not even a half mile from my house. But there are three times dogs have come out at us between my house and the Rosehill track. So now we drive to the track. Nothing has changed, and this has been going on for 2 years.
Actually, Mr. Barrows had told me he was going to try to come tonight, but he's not here.
Barrows?
Well, I will just, since it was in the paper and since I did speak with the family and they had hoped to come, there was another incident in regard to a dog on dog on Main Street. And Karen is here. I'll just briefly, and if you want to add to it, you can. And the gentleman, Mr. Barrows, was walking two small dogs on Main Street. He lives on Main Street in Portland. And as he was going on the sidewalk, he went to the corner of Co Avenue and Main Street. And a dog whose owner said the leash around the dog was under his foot. The dog saw the two little dogs and ran, getting loose from under his foot and attacked one of the two small dogs, and within a short amount of time, the dog was killed. Mr. Barrows and Mrs. Barrows are very upset, obviously, and Karen, our animal control officer, Karen Prucci, is here tonight. Do you want to comment on the next, how you enforce the law on that matter, Karen? And if you take the microphone, you have to come up. Karen Ferruccio, our animal control officer.
What did this happen?
Recently?
Yes.
Hi, I'm Karen Ferruccio, animal control officer of Portland. It happened a couple weeks ago, and I had to call the state because when it's animal versus animal, you usually don't have to quarantine the animal. And in this case, he wasn't up to date on bringing these, so I was able to quarantine the animal. But at the house because it happened on property. So, but now the dog has stipulations, has to be walked with a muzzle at all times.
But you can't order a dog to be put down.
No.
At this point,
no.
Because it was the
first
report.
Offense.
Right, the first report to the animal control person.
That's a muzzle and leash, right?
Yes. Yes.
And
what? You can't put down the state ordinance or the town ordinance?
The state and town can't put an animal to sleep on the first offense. It's by law. Unfortunately, that's the law.
Mrs. Barrows wants a change of law.
And even when it bites first. If there's a first offense and you don't have any evidence of a first offense somewhere else, that's the law.
And the reason to bring it up is Mrs. Barrows did say to me in the office that they would be willing to work with the town and our legislator to see if the law can't be changed. They feel very strongly about this and will work with us in any way possible.
So if I may, I know Omar Rosa, was that the first offense for that dog?
I have no idea.
Yes.
And so you're saying in no way that it would be put down for the first offense?
No, we're not. That's a different case.
Okay.
That's a different case. Yeah, I don't want to get them confused.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm only speaking because Mr. Barrows couldn't be here.
Okay.
Now, in terms of Mrs. Demarest's dog, the animal control officer ordered the dog to be put down.
Okay.
And that was sustained by my office. I agreed with the animal control officer. And the owner appealed our animal control officer's decision to put the dog down to the State Department of Agriculture. And there's been, I believe, two hearings.
Oh, yes. We only went to one. I don't know if your lawyers went to another.
There was one hearing, and I was fully expecting a report from the state of Connecticut. We have no report. whether they will uphold the animal control officer's decision for to euthanize or not uphold. There's been nothing.
Yes,
and then there was another, I don't know if I want to call it a hearing, but there was another meeting, and
yes,
the town's attorney was present. And I have heard nothing as a result of that.
Your lawyer was there.
I think your attorney was there. I'd get more details for you on that.
What does the state have for attacking our animals?
They're backed up a lot. I mean, they, you know, they're even, they're checking up on towns and grooming shops and stuff like that. They're behind a lot. They're all behind right now.
Yeah, but in this case, it's obviously costing the taxpayers more than wanting the house to stay on the roof. They need to render a decision, so you're saying.
I agree. We agree. We don't have the jurisdiction, but they're not responding now.
The statute doesn't have a taxpayer for them to render their decisions.
No.
Okay, so that's one of the things that I'm saying, and also, I guess,
yes.
Then you go on for a long time.
Well, there's another case that, in another town with two rides that we were for, and that's going on three years now.
This is the right time for us to be talking about this because the legislative session will be starting soon. So I'll share this with Christy Carpino to see if there can't be some legislative change requests made. So time frame for rendering decisions.
Yeah, that's obviously everything has to have a new process. So far, I hear there is a process. It can't be open-ended. It can't be because something's busy. Or doing something, you know, that.
Well, I know they
yeah,
not,
no,
you know,
yeah.
I'm not.
I'm not putting you on the spot. You're saying
no.
The statute needs to be clarified,
right.
And it needs to be specific, and it cannot be open.
Did they check to see if the dog had rabies or some disease or something?
No, the dog's fine. Dog was up to date on everything. It was a territorial. We had an evaluator came to evaluate the dog, and he said he wrote it. We have the statute that we wrote, and he said the dog's territory, so protecting his property. Some dogs are like that, and you don't know that when you adopt them out. Nobody knows that when we adopt a 2-year-old or a 3-year-old, or even a 6-month-old sometimes. It's the nature of the dog. And it doesn't matter if it's a pit, it could be a lab, it could be a bull.
Deborah's were walking by this property.
They were
across the street from the house, when the dog came across the street.
The dog came down the driveway and across the street.
We don't have any recourse in the board taking action.
The only thing that I'm bringing, as Mrs. Demers is bringing to your attention, and as the Barrows family has brought to our attention, is the request to work with us toward changing the laws so that there can be, as Ben pointed out, an answer, and that there also be, I don't know if there was anything else specific that you had suggested.
The laws need to change. I don't agree with them having the opportunity to go to
appeal.
Agriculture board. I don't think there should be an appeal process. Not when something like this happens.
We're paying the house, the dog, and feeding the dog now, currently, correct?
Yes. I take care of all the animals there. I get paid to take care of whatever's there.
So,
no, that's my job.
The food, who's paying for the food?
He's just eating what I buy with all the other dogs.
The owner doesn't bring food?
He was for a while. I told him it didn't matter because we have the food there.
Right. I think our ordinance is very efficient, say, and especially if people are taking the appeal. Well, you know what? You're taking the appeal, you're going to...
There is a charge requirement.
Well, when a dog's on hold, the owner doesn't have to bring anything for the dog.
It's only when they're impounded.
Right, when they're quarantined and for the 14 days they bring their own food, and then they get paid the $7 a day.
So he's not being charged right now?
No. Because it's in it.
It's really not his, it's not the owner's responsibility hasn't responded.
Right.
Right, is that what you're saying?
But it's costing a lot of money.
Yes, it is.
And we're not gonna get it. And this has been going on for how long?
2 years, 2 years now.
Waiting for the state for 2 years?
Mr. Bell's called the state, I've called the state, and they just go, keep telling us there's no answer.
Isn't this damaging to the dog, because we've now, caged the dog 2 years?
The dog thinks I'm his owner right now.
But it's just as damaging to the dog, because the dog's been caged for 2 years, right? So it's not good all the way around, I would think.
Well, the owner comes every day to visit. Owner is there.
But he says the dog thinks you're his owner.
Yes, so now,
you're his territory.
And when he goes back, if the agricultural board says he can go back home, he's gonna attack the new, his new owner.
No, he sees Paul every day, so he won't attack him.
And I think I'm a hostage in my own home.
Yeah, that's pretty, anyway, it looks like it's not at all.
And I pronounced in the hallway, I do patrol.
I have not seen him, I'm sorry. But I've been up to the reservoir, it's like everybody's running free up here.
There are other matters that I wanted to bring forward to the selectmen. We did look at some other towns' ordinances. And we had shared this with the selectmen as well as with others. There's copies up here if anybody wants it. And you remember that Mr. and Mrs. Rudder were here earlier, and they have concerns about dogs going on private property. And you can see in the Clinton ordinance, no owner or keeper of any dog shall allow such dog to roam upon land of another unless owner has given the owner or keeper of such dog permission to have such dog present on said land. I don't know that we have that, Karen, in our ordinance, that roaming on land of other
Michelle and I looked up there.
You also have copies, I think, of the current animal ordinances.
And we have some of the other towns too.
And as has been pointed out to me, many of these ordinances refer to places that maybe have dog parks, or how dogs can go on other properties, town properties, open space.
So yeah, I think you were originally referring to section 5.3 of the Portland ordinance of roaming nuisance of animals. That's what the Portland town ordinance is.
Yes.
No owner or animal shall allow such animal to create a nuisance or roam at large within the town while it is not controlled by means of a leash or the owner or agent of the owner, provided that nothing is in this section shall be construed to limit or prohibit the use of hunting dogs during the open hunting or training season for any animal performed or being exhibited in a fence show or exhibition. That's the roaming nuisance animal for Portland for section 5-3.
Right. Weren't you requesting that that be strengthened? That
well, there's some ambiguity because when we were given a ticket, Portland has this roaming, but the state reads differently. The state statute on roaming reads differently than ours does. And so that's what gets the public confused as well, because we have ordinances and the state has ordinances. So when you want people to understand what's happening, there's the ambiguity between the way that you read the state of Connecticut's roaming ordinances, which is section 22.364 of the state, dogs roaming at large, intentional or reckless subsequent violation. No owner or keeper of any dog shall allow such dog to roam at large upon the land of another and not under control of the fowler or keeper or the agent of the owner or keeper. And this also goes on to talk about trespassing. So there's a lot more in the state than the town. So when the town of Portland, as an owner, you don't know, because there's a lot of ambiguity between the two. Same with the nuisance. See, we have our 5.3 is roaming and nuisance, where the state has its own nuisance. So
it's a separate one. And so between the two, I think the residents of Portland are confused when it comes to laws being set aside. And if we're gonna change ours, we really have to look at the wording between the state and Portland and make sure we have clarity, as well as the one that you had handed out in your papers up there, because it talks about how different towns have parks. We don't have a park. So it makes it a lot different because we're talking about public space in town. People have private property in towns that have a park. You can control that if it's in a fenced area. So we have to talk about how we would get the dogs to and from that, on a leash, off a leash, and in these notes that I hope you don't mind me paraphrasing some because Michelle did a good job with it and I went through it. They're talking about the length of a leash.
Right.
Shall we walk on a dog on a 6-foot leash, on a 5-foot leash? Well, that's okay if we're going on public property. But say the downtown area, I mean, I live on East Main Street. If you walked a dog on a 6-foot leash, you're in my yard. At 10 feet, you're at my front door. And we've already had that problem where people's dogs are defecating on my front step at 10 feet. And that's where we had our incident where people were trespassing in our yard. And we had a dog incident where a dog attacked our dog at and in our property. So that's where we have to be careful of the ambiguity if we are going to put a distance on the length of a leash. Because you could take 6 feet, add the 2 feet of somebody's arm, that's really 8. If you take 8 feet, like Ron Gillen McCain, and add 2 feet, that's 10. And you walk down any of the streets like Fairview, my mother owns 260 East Main Street, and my husband has a picture. If you have somebody on the sidewalk walking the dog, and you're 10 feet, you're on her front step. So it really gets really gray when we're trying to decide if we're going to put a distance on the length of a leash. And there's a lot going on to what's happened with Mrs. Demarest, us, Bill Barrows, and how we want the public to perceive what their rights can be, what we need to do to move forward to make sure these ordinances work well for everybody.
There's a lot of laws. There's a lot of laws in front of me right now from all different places.
Yeah.
I mean, there's one here, the general statutes do not mandate that dogs be on a leash at all times, but one, a dog's owner or keeper must not allow it to roam on another person's land or on a public highway, including sidewalks. If it is not under control, two, the local governments may create leash ordinance. Violations in state roaming law is an infraction punishable. So there's all different laws. I mean, you could look at all of them, all through the states, all through the towns. Everybody has a different law. So the only thing we can do is Susan and I can sit together and think of what we can do. We go by just the state.
We can try to update these in relation to some of the comments that we've gotten. And then I think also, Karen, we need to set up a time to talk with Christy Carpino's, Representative Carpino's office, and give information about the request by some of our residents in terms of dog upon dog killing and whether a dog can be punished for that, as well on first offense, as well as euthanized when attacking in a vicious manner another person. I don't know about our success, but we can certainly present it and it can be put forward. I mean, these are very difficult pictures to look at. And they're very, this case on Omaha Road Turnpike was a very vicious attack. And it's very frightening. And it's not the only place that this happens. These are just three testimonies here tonight, but there's been others too. I witnessed a dog killing a cat. Dog, again, was on a leash, and the dog got loose, grabbed the cat that was behaving in a tree, just sitting there, killed the cat within seconds. And there's nothing that could be done.
This dog was being on a leash.
In your case, it was a human that was. There are laws against
what if
that.
It was
but
a child. Your husband's a big man.
Yeah.
You know, and he did some serious damage. That was a little kid.
Oh, and many, many times we have walked our grandchildren in strollers by our hand up that street, past that house. Many, many times. I don't even want to think about what it could be.
Sure.
Yeah.
the hearing, the appeal hearing, is causing most of the problem. Most of the stuff I read here is that you're supposed to hear back within a relatively soon time, maybe 14 days.
They had told, they had told us in August we're supposed to hear back.
Right, and they're not, and whether they're backlogged or not, we have a problem with that because we have dogs that are attacking people, dogs that killed another dog, dogs that potentially could even kill a child, and we have an appeal process through the state. Is there something that we, or Susan, or yourself can do, or maybe we need to go through Christy Carpino and say, you know, it's been, I think you said over a month now? Yeah, and so it's unacceptable, and I think that in some way our views to Susan, to you, to Christy, has to go to the, I think it's the Agricultural Department of the State Department, and say, listen, we have really a big problem here in Portland, and it could be disastrous.
And two, if they do make a decision, Paul Bell can appeal it again, and it'll go to
the second appeal. I read that. Which once again, everything is due process. And,
right.
And I guess if you have to do that, that's fine. But the due process on part of the state is that they have to get back to you within a reasonable amount of time after the first hearing, so that if there is a second hearing, there's a reasonable amount of time after the second hearing that something can be done, so that a decision can be made. Whether that dog is put down or whether that dog is put in quarantine, whatever it may be, those decisions need to be made. And it doesn't seem like the state is cooperating with us, and I think maybe we need to voice our opinion as a board to the state and say, we need to know what's going on. Because this is poor. I'm guessing that this is not just an isolated situation here. There's probably similar situations in the other 169 towns in the state of Connecticut. That's probably why they're backlogged, but that shows you that something needs to be done.
If you want to take a motion to direct me to send a letter to the department, I will tell you that our attorney has been in constant contact, but to raise it now to the Board of Selectmen, I think it's appropriate, absolutely. And we will certainly send that letter. So
I'll make a motion to write a letter.
On behalf of the Board of Selectmen, per their direction, do this motion.
And can we, one, can we ask them for reimbursement for all the out-of-pocket costs? I think at some point, it's gross negligence on their part, not following the law. I think it's ridiculous, to say the least. The state of Connecticut has dropped the ball. 2 years, this is ridiculous.
Yeah,
I think we need to get whatever language you can use to say that legal action is coming or what have you.
I will, Joe Schwartz.
To me, that's ridiculous.
Joe Schwartz was here as our attorney the other night. Remember, he came and talked to us about state laws and freedom of information and so forth. He has been representing us in this case because, after all, the appeal is to the town of Portland's order. So they have not responded to the town of Portland's animal control officer's order, which has been appealed. I will get in touch with them tomorrow to make sure the letter is drafted and we copy to them. Motion's been made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Yes. And we will also work on the animal ordinances. In light of the current law, we will also be in touch with Christy Kirby. Okay.
May I ask one more thing? Because in our own town ordinances, under section 5.4, regulation of vicious dogs, under C, item C, because we have A, B, C, it says control of vicious dogs. All vicious dogs shall be confined to an enclosure. So why haven't we forced Mr. Bell to have this enclosure so that the cost vector is on him and not us?
Go ahead, Karen.
The dog cannot be released.
We will not allow that.
Right.
Oh, okay.
We will not allow the dog to be released. It must be impounded because of the order of the animal control officer to euthanize the dog.
Well, before then, how does that make it any different than this new dog that killed Mr. Barrows' dog.
That's another situation.
It's a different situation. It's dog versus dog, not dog versus person. There are different laws for dog versus dog and dog versus person.
Okay.
We have to abide by the laws.
Okay.
Unfortunately.
And what we're saying.
If this here says the muzzle, oh, well, because this one here, it also talks about how the muzzle, because this new dog has to be muzzled. It says the muzzle shall be prevented of the. The muzzle shall be made in such a manner so that to prevent it from biting a person or animal. So this one, this dog bit a person. Now that was a dog on dog, so we're still got ambiguity in the language.
No, this dog with Mr. Demarest has been ordered to be put down.
Okay, yes.
So that dog is impounded and is not free.
Okay.
The other dog, upon dog, that issue. There is no law that allows Karen, as our animal control officer, to impound that dog.
Right.
She legally cannot do that, and that is what was being asked by the owner of the dog who was killed.
Right. Is that per state, or could we write it in?
It's per state. Karen, you're the expert here.
It's the state law. Animal versus animal, we don't have to quarantine him. Unless it attacks wildlife animal that we don't know has rabies, then I can quarantine the dog if it's not up to date. We can quarantine for 6 months. The person pays for that. I had to do that a couple years ago. I had to do that. My dog attacked a raccoon and we tested the raccoon and came back positive. The dog wasn't up to date, so I had to quarantine for 6 months. The owner paid for that 6 months.
But this dog that attacked Mr. Barrow, he wasn't up to date either with his rabies.
Right, and that was the only reason I was able to quarantine.
You can't quarantine him because you want to quarantine him.
No.
Or you think it's the right thing to do.
Okay. Right. It's the laws. We have so many laws in the laws. There are different cases, different scenarios.
And Karen is a certified animal control officer, and she does have to go through hours of training to maintain that certification.
Right.
And she does do that.
And she does.
I'm sorry.
And extra classes.
These are very important issues that we will. We'll use the second meeting of the month for this, as opposed to the first meeting, which can deal with more financial matters. So the second meeting in January, we'll talk some more, and I'll give an update as to what we got. That's the third Wednesday. Thank you, Karen. The other item that's under ordinances, I'm going to move on to, is sidewalks. And I know that we have a report on our sidewalk ordinance committee that has met twice from Chairman Jim Trent.
Yeah, basically the sidewalk committee has met twice. We've been meeting on Monday mornings, basically this past Monday and the Monday previous. We had the committee there as well as our first selectman Bransfield. We had Mr. Kelsey. We had other guests as well. Shire was with us as some, and so was
John Hall,
Ralph. So we had a good group to sit down and try and talk. And really, what we're trying to do is organize and take a look at the existing ordinances that are in place. Start to take a look at where we have what the ordinances are in the surrounding towns, and how that plays into the situation that we have. Right. The goal that we're trying to look at here is how do we get to a point where we can start to improve our sidewalks. Get a program in place that is sustainable, and there's an awful lot of money that would be required to do them all at once. We have to figure out a sustainable process, a program that can allow us to start moving in the right direction, and something that we can keep going year after year. So we've looked at some of the other sidewalk ordinances from some of our neighbors. There's a range, and that range goes from the municipality pays unless there's damage that occurs by a property owner, right? And they range right to the butter pays unless there's damage that occurs because of a tree or something that's caused by a municipality. So it's a full range. There's also, you see some zoned arrangements where sidewalks, for example, in one of our neighbors, the sidewalks that are within a certain zone and a certain downtown route that they've established, they cover those. Sidewalks that are remote from that in other neighborhoods are 100% the
responsibility of the body. So there's quite a range for us to consider, and it really is taking a look at the work that the sidewalk committee has done and their recommendations, and how we can best leverage the ordinance to try to move things forward in the best way forward.
It's not an easy charge.
Complicated.
Very. Anything else that anyone wants to add?
I think right next steps, we know that the sidewalk committee is meeting again in early January. I think there's going to be some additional discussions there. We're going to get some additional feedback. We're continuing to do the homework that we have to do, and then we'll set another meeting after we get that. We're busy already to get some additional information.
Do you know what their schedule?
I don't remember. I know it was early
January 4th for a meeting.
Thank you.
But if I could ask the question, because that's going to come up now, are you expecting the sidewalk committee to give input on the ordinance?
No.
Okay, that's, I'm clear.
No.
True. No.
Okay.
You're right.
I'm clear
that
on that.
That is not their charge.
No.
Thank you.
We just want to know their progress.
Yes.
Ken?
Yeah, are we going to have three questions? Are those going to be answered soon? If we don't, in other words, soon to give those.
Ordinance does say that the selectmen can make the decision as to where sidewalks can. We did review that, Ben. So yes, the selectmen turn to sidewalk section, which is
17. And then obviously the next public hearing.
The Board of Selectmen be and are hereby authorized to build and maintain sidewalks to an extent that will not exceed in cost 15% of the amount that is annually expended on its pilot.
No, I was referring to the referendum, to the bond question.
That we can put in new sidewalks?
Correct, versus repairing what we already have. We're already kind of the eight holes in.
It does not talk about only repair. Just double check my language. I have it with me.
Right, but
I don't go anywhere without my sidewalk.
No problem. And I'm sure that's going to be one of the things that comes up in the next public hearing. Here we are. We don't have enough money to maintain what we have. And if we're then proposing putting it new in other areas, even if it's only 500 feet, 300 feet, I don't care what it is, we don't even have the money to maintain the sidewalks we have and keep those safe.
So the resolution recommending the appropriation of bond authorization says, and I'll read the section, letter B, the reconstruction and repair of various town roads and roadside elements, which shall include, but shall not be limited to, related water and sewer infrastructure improvements in the amount of $2,500,000, and sidewalks, including sidewalks located adjacent to the town school facilities, in the amount of $1 million with specific roads and sidewalks to be determined by the Board of Selectmen. And when I spoke with Bruce Chudwick, he said that was written, at least for sidewalks, in a pretty broad definition.
That tells me it has to be a sidewalk within a whatever half mile of school. And a sidewalk is not within a half mile of school because it doesn't even exist.
No, it says including that. It doesn't say only.
No, it says...
with specific roads and sidewalks,
sidewalks
to be
sidewalks
determined by the Board of Selectmen.
Right.
It's in your power.
I don't know. I think that's a tough one. You know, we have a lot of sidewalks that are in disarray. I do like the fact that we're trying to connect a few here and there. It makes sense. That's not my agenda here. But the reality is we've got a lot of the sidewalks that are just simply just not safe. And I think before we start adding to it, we've got to come up with a game plan.
And that is your decision.
Right, feasibly and sustainably.
That is your decision.
A lot of money?
Yes, without a doubt. Okay, anything else? Rick?
Are we bound by the ordinance? Does that $1 million have to go, let me ask it another way. if we had a sidewalk ordinance where there was a cost share, or let's just say, I think Cromwell, like Cromwell has one, where the owner pays 50% and the town pays 50%, or something like that, one of the town. So, could be an instance to.
They make assessments, I believe, right, Jim?
Yeah.
What I'm getting at, we make $1 million go farther, cover more footage, if there was cost share.
And the bond council said that because you're pretty broad in this area, you are the authority on this. However, he pointed out that at the time your bond was talked about, we didn't talk specifically about this. So he said you have to, of course, as you do with everything, be careful on how you decide things, and that everyone is informed as to what we're doing. And I had suggested at the last public hearing, which was held in September, October, that we have another public hearing so that people that do have sidewalks, and particularly those that are in the area that is first going to be considered, Rick, by the committee, that we let them know and inform them as to how we're going to proceed. But it's up to this board.
But you can also go back and say, we already have an ordinance, even though it hasn't been enforced, that says the property owner is supposed to.
If as so directed by the Office of Personnel.
So.
It has to be directed by.
And I'm not saying we take the heavy hand, but I mean, it's, there already is something in place that if it was enforced. In other words, what I'm getting at is, by putting up some money, we're actually doing better than the ordinance that's already on the books.
Yes.
Because if we follow the ordinance by the word, we would be having a bunch of people be having.
If ordered by the first one.
Okay.
They have to be ordered.
I'm not saying we do that. I'm just.
You can't, but you can do that, is what I'm saying. You are correct. But if you were to have a cost sharing of some type, which was talked about during the public hearing, there was some discussion on that. But I want to make it clear that we have not ordered people to do that. Now, some responsible property owners have taken out the proper permits and have done the work and paid 100% for the sidewalks in front of the property. Rick?
I just wanted to share with you what I kind of asked it the other night we were talking.
If you wouldn't mind, Rick, I know I've gotten a number of complaints from people that we, the board, not so much you, Rick, but the board doesn't talk into the microphone.
Oh, yeah.
And I've
been
asked again and again and again, please talk into your microphone.
That's a rookie mistake.
No problem at all. We are making, I think, we're having very good discussions on the ordinance. I think that's a lot too. But I asked the question the last time, do you want the, and there's some different thoughts here, which are good. I'm proceeding. As a matter of fact, I met with the town engineer this afternoon for a couple of hours, and we're moving forward with the recommendation of the subcommittee, which does in fact include some additional sidewalks. And I just want to be sure you want me to continue along those lines. Again, the subcommittee's goal, my goal, is to get the package out, and I think we're going to do it. The next couple of months, and a good bidding plan. Do you want me to keep going that way? Are you okay? I mean, we haven't really got the ordinance thing resolved, which is fine. And we've got some differences, I think, of opinion as to questioning, does the bond resolution allow additional sidewalks? And I'm not hearing a yay or a nay, so I mean, do you want?
I said it was the decision of this board.
And that's what
right,
the board wants to do.
I'll speak for myself, which I've already told you many times.
Yes.
I'm just one of seven.
Yes.
I think it's a worthwhile project. I think that the voters voted to repair sidewalks, and I think that you should continue with the project. How this board decides they may continue in terms of either making an assessment or not, that's this board's decision. But I don't think we stopped and not fixed sidewalks. So I don't know how others feel.
Well, I think, once again, I don't think you answered this. I don't believe we should be putting in the new sidewalks until we have the ones that we already are saying we're going to maintain and we're going to maintain them. Let's fix those. By putting in new ones, we've now added additional liability that doesn't exist right now for the town. We can't even afford the ones we have. We need to move forward with that. So I also want to move forward with $1 million like the taxpayers have said, but I want to do it on the existing ones.
Just to be clear, we're talking about connecting of sidewalks where there's empty, where there's one in particular, because the neighbor to the land has written to this board and said she doesn't want sidewalks, but it connects existing sidewalks to another existing sidewalk. There is a gap, and that is on Freestone Avenue, right? So there is a gap between Cross Street.
There's three locations, so let's be clear.
Yep.
So the three locations are...
So we're not going in a new neighborhood and creating sidewalks. I don't want to mislead the audience.
There's a section specifically in front of Daniel's Park, which connects to sidewalks. So there's a section there that is not existing that would be, as part of the recommendation, subcommittee constructed. There's the section of sidewalk from Cross Street on the south side, the intersection across, going heading toward High Street, that would go from that point to existing Portland Electric sidewalk. And there is a piece of sidewalk on the north side of Freestone Cross Street in front of one property there that is contemplated being added. These are all connecting existing, but they are new. And so just so you're clear, I'm not suggesting anything. I'm
just so I'm clear, I think it's great to connect them. And I think when we have a project and the money to do so be it. Right now, talking about what we have on the sidewalks that are in disarray and they need repair, those come first. That's my only point. I think it's
I'm
wonderful.
Not arguing at all.
Yeah, no, I think it's wonderful to tie all that in.
I think this board can, I think it's a good point.
And I'm only placing that. I'm just one guy.
Good point.
One vote. Oh, thank you.
My perspective is I would think that we're probably it's good to proceed because the work that's being done right now, regardless of whether or not we come up with a cost sharing model that will enable us to do more sidewalks or however that works out, this is necessary work for those areas. So it's going to have to be done. So it's proceeding.
And Ben, I will make every attempt to attend on the 4th, as will Rick, and we'll convey that to the committee what your thoughts are in terms of the limited amount of dollars we have and where sidewalks can be.
And maybe we have extra in the road fund.
Yep.
And that would be where it would be appropriate to then do that. Right now, $1 million, I think, I was under the impression we were going to start fixing something. And the other thing I want to add is I think you should leave a little kitty, $50,000 or whatever, for ones that are outside this area that just need to be fixed, a few sections here and there, that people are going to get hurt. I mean, and I know that's going to cost more. I know it's
going
to be. I
know
what
you're saying, too.
Yeah.
Ben, you're right. Rick?
The ordinance committee has discussed number of things. One is coming up with an ordinance and what type of ordinance and all that. We also discussed at budget time, which is coming fairly soon, of putting such as you do for your land acquisition. You have land with this ordinance. You have to every year put in $50,000 for land acquisition. I suggest if you really are serious about your sidewalk, you do the same thing, and that would be monies that could be used for such as what you're doing. So there's a lot of discussion, and we're looking at all kinds of different things to do with sidewalks. So these things have been discussed.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm okay with proceeding. I just was bringing up the point that if we end up with some sort of cost here, that we might be able to make $1 million further and therefore cover more footage of sidewalks.
Do you want to schedule another public? Are you ready for a public hearing?
I think we need to, and we need to ask. At the first public hearing, we asked the public, "Do you want to know your sidewalks?" It was overwhelming. They did,
yep.
And I was surprised. I wanted to do it on one side of every street, making the same walk. The public wanted to keep their walk, so be it. But now we need to talk about whether there's going to be cost sharing. Let's get the same. Let's feel out their reaction, and let's see what they say. You know, and we may be surprised, and that's fine. Want to pay. Right now, the ordinance says pay 100%. You know, right now, they only need to pay 2/3. We might be able to do lots of neighborhoods and make Portland much better and much safer. We'll well, these are the things we need to get answers to. I think those need to happen sooner than later, and let's get the reaction. We're just still, we need the answers to those few legal questions, and then we need the public's response. Let's really schedule a meeting.
Well, we could go to the second, when, I mean, the second meeting, which is the 17th of January. Sound good? Want to do it at what time?
You should have this money, right? The money meeting.
You want to have some time for the subcommittee to meet at least once or twice.
Exactly. To be able to put a couple, make sure we have some things that we've been talking about, but we want to have them to some kind of coherent, you know, model to discuss.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, we've talked about, you know, three or four different solutions at those meetings, and I'd like to get some feedback from the town on what they're doing. You know, we certainly talked at length about cost sharing, so I'd be interested to hear more comments along that line. You know, we've talked about a fund. We really have. I think the solution's going to end up being a combination, because I don't think you can go one thing only. Right? That's what I would envision as a solution. That's a multi-faceted.
How do you want me to notice such a public hearing? Similar to the last time?
Well, it worked.
So we'll use the same format. Start at 6:30 on the 17th of January,
yeah.
And it'll be a public hearing on the topic of sidewalks. And I'll look back at the language that we used last time, which I think was helpful as that. Is there a motion to that effect?
I'll make a motion. Oh, sorry.
Motion made by Ralph and seconded by Ben to have the public hearing on sidewalks. And how we're going to proceed with the implementation of the bond. True?
Yep.
On the 17th of January, starting at 6:30 here in America. Yes, Ben?
Maybe go a little more out, because pretty much we should be able to get a decision out of that. Hopefully helps that or somehow, yeah. Whatever you got to
do our best.
Say, yeah.
We're not going to mail to everybody in town.
No.
We'll do our best to mail it out. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries. Thank you, Rick.
Thank you.
Okay.
May I say something? For those of you that are,
yes,
new board members, you may want to look at the last public meeting on sidewalks, because it was quite contentious. And there are some people that have some very strong opinions, and some of them who have been, I mean, we don't care. We put our sidewalk in, so we don't care. But there are some other people in town felt that if they bought and paid for their sidewalk, are looking for compensation from the town if you decide to go into this cost sharing, even on the ones that are already in existence. And it got quite contentious that evening. So that's something that you might want to see in that last, because you'll know the faces that come and you'll be prepared for the contention that will show up.
Good advice, Sarah. Thank you.
And I will know I was there, so I did this.
And there's one other thing for the new board member,
yes,
regarding something,
yeah,
about the one on Main Street. The one on Main Street that you guys are arguing with the state about who's going to fix the sidewalk, whether you fix it, the town fixes it, or the state fixes it,
yeah,
is the same argument that we're having whether you make town people fix the,
true,
sidewalk or you fix the sidewalk, because you are having a fight with the state about fixing the sidewalk on Main Street and refusing to fix it, but yet you're getting ready to try to make a decision on people who own the property adjacent to your sidewalk and making them to fix it. So, and that was one of the complicated things, because I found it pretty hypocritical that I was actually forced to fix my sidewalk 20 years ago. I was told they were going to put a lien on my house if I didn't fix the sidewalk. So for them to say that, but they said they have never forced somebody to fix their sidewalk. I was forced to fix my sidewalk. And I was not fixing my sidewalk until the fiber optic cable went in. And then they told me to fix it. They wouldn't touch my sidewalk. And then 3 weeks after I fixed my sidewalk, they decided to try to cut across my sidewalk and cut a section out of it. So this is another issue that goes deep and wide, because if you're going to force people to fix it and then go to cut it or go to do stuff, and you guys are having the same argument that you're trying to dictate to the town people that they have to pay, then the town should have to pay to fix the sidewalk with the state before they go around and say that the people of the town of Portland need to fix, pay it out of pocket. I mean, especially with the sidewalks that aren't even in place that you want to put in place. If there's not a sidewalk on their property and you decide to put one there and they don't want it there, who's going to be responsible? You're giving them a cost of effectiveness that they've never had.
As far as shoveling it.
As far as shoveling, maintaining it, you're saying I'm going to put a sidewalk there and I'm going to dictate that you maintain it.
We'll have to keep all those things in consideration and make sure that we keep them line with the laws and the spirit of the bond.
Watch that meeting, and then you'll come here with your football gear on first, and you'll be like, okay, I get this.
Yeah, that was a very instructive public hearing. It was an excellent public hearing. There was points on all sides of it, and I can also say some of the issues, exact issues you're talking about, we are talking about in the ordinance committee meetings.
John Jarzabek made a good comment about how perhaps the town could come up with a company that could give you a bid on reducing the cost, then if you did some sort of weather, so that you could get a contractor that would do them, and then this way when you went to homeowners, if they got to reduce costs and you're going to do so many, that also might help in putting in sidewalks. And he kind of made that suggestion.
Putting, repairing, you mean replacing the ones that are...
Or even new ones? Well, again, if you were going to go ahead and do these, and you wanted to put it to homeowners saying, hey, we're going to have this program, and whether you're going to pay for it fully or there's a cost sharing, we have a contractor that's coming in on a really low bid and we got a good deal on it, and that might also help, knowing that you may have, 200 sidewalks, and if you get this good deal on that, versus if one person goes, I'm going to use this contractor, and I'm going to use this contractor, and you could get a uniform product and quality all the way across the board.
Very good. Okay, we're going to move on to the next item, which is appointments to boards and commissions, if I'm not mistaken. Double check. Yes, appointments to boards and commissions. I had nothing on the ethics ordinance tonight, but we will continue to work out these other three. Done one, stormwater, right? We've done that tonight.
Yes.
So we just have two. And as I get more information on them, I will share that. Okay, appointments to boards and commissions. Many of our boards and commission appointments sunset in December of 2017. So we have a number of them tonight to either reappoint or new appointments. And I have a list, and I've shared it with the selectmen previous to the meeting. And I've asked Jim to start with some of these nominations. And here's some copies in case anyone wanted to see.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yes.
All right, I guess I would nominate to the Norman Wood to the Conservation Commission.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries.
I nominate Fred Piazza to the Economic Development Commission.
Second.
Yeah, I have copies if other selectmen want them. Anybody want them? Here's this end of the table.
I have the list.
Okay. Right. So did we take a vote on that? All set?
On Greg's, I don't.
Okay, Greg.
Vote on.
Is there a motion been made and seconded?
Yes.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries.
I have a motion to nominate Ron Millardo to the Emergency Management Advisory Board.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Nominate Raymond Zajac to the Emergency Management Advisory Board.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Nominate James Provoz to the Ethics Commission.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Nominate A. Tom White Jr. to the Housing Authority.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries.
Nominate Christopher Flood to the Inland Wetlands Commission.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries.
Nominate Betsy Graziano to the Library Board of Directors.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Nominate Gary Nolan to the Long Range Capital Improvements Commission.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Nominate Nita Philanda to the Parks and Recreation Commission as an alternate.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any extensions? Motion carries.
I nominate Carol Freeman to the Planning and Zoning Commission.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Extensions? Motion carries.
I nominate Michael Warnoff to the Planning and Zoning Commission as an alternate.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
I nominate Ruth Mayo to the Senior Citizens Advisory Board.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
I nominate Norman Ward to the Water and Sewer Commission.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
I nominate David Kosminski to the Water and Sewer Commission.
Second.
Also seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
I nominate Chris Chenier, to the Conservation Commission.
Second.
These are for appointments.
Yeah, be appointed to them, yeah.
Newly appointed.
Yes.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
I nominate Alan Fenro to be appointed to the Inland Wetlands Commission.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
I nominate Karen Appleotti to be nominated for the Parks and Recreation Commission.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
I nominate Kevin Backman to the Parks and Recreation Commission.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
I nominate Deb Ruth to the Parks and Recreation Commission.
All in favor?
Aye.
That was seconded by Ben as well. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
I nominate Bernice Zampano to the Parks and Recreation Commission.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any extensions? Motion carries.
I nominate David Lapadilla as an alternate to the Parks and Recreation Commission.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
We'll get that. All right, I nominate Jacqueline Germain to the Conservation Commission.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
I nominate Frank Winiski to the Economic Development Commission.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
I nominate George Law to the Ethics Commission.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
I nominate Robert Ellsworth to the Planning and Zoning Commission.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
I nominate Carol Cully to the Senior Citizens Advisory Board.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
I nominate Carol Gilbert to the Youth Services Advisory Board.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
I nominate Dana Gary as an alternate to the Youth Services Advisory Board.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. And one last one.
Yeah, one last.
It's not on the list, but there's a committee.
Yeah. Yeah, I nominate Carol Winiski as an alternate to the LA Trail Committee.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Sharon, did you get that last night?
Yeah, which board was it?
Airline Trail Committee.
It's a committee as opposed to a board or commission.
And she would be as an alternate.
Carol?
Winiski, W-I-N-I-S-K-I.
Are there any other appointments to boards and commissions or committees tonight? Then move on to new business. Annually, we have an authorizing resolution that the selectmen pass in order for us to utilize through the CROG agency, the State Homeland Security Grant. It's a small amount that comes back to us, and the resolution is in front of you. I'll entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
Seconded those through Krogman, and we have asked them for shirts sometimes and some other kinds of materials that would be only used in Portland. And they also utilize this on behalf of the town in terms of things like the Red Plan, where there's a major disaster, and they have the equipment and supplies for us to utilize as part of the third region 3. Used to be a lot more money, and over the years it has gone down substantially. Motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Refund of excess payments. Luke?
No, they made the motion to refund Toyota Lease Trust in the amount of $308.83.
Second.
Seconded by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries. I think we had status and committee reports really during our ordinances. I don't have anything in addition to add, so I'll open it up for public comment. Move on to general informal discussion. Again, I think most of the updates have been covered tonight. We had a good session on updating things. And I want to wish everyone Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays. This is our last meeting before Christmas. And I hope everyone has a peaceful new year. Very important. Nothing under follow-up because we've already covered it. And I have nothing under executive session, so that will not occur tonight. So I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
I'll second it.
Seconded by Jim. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.